Today we have 13 candidates with us, and we're going to start with four questions from the Yellowknife Chamber, and then we'll move into questions from the audience. Candidates have already drawn for their speaking order, which also determine their seating arrangements. Due to the number of candidates who have put their name forward, each question will be asked to a row of candidates. This will prevent us from having 13 different answers to each question and will allow us to take more questions from the audience. If a candidate feels passionately about a question that they don't have an opportunity to answer, I encourage you to email me a written submission, which we will publish online. We're also providing an opportunity for the three candidates who are unable to attend to provide written answers to our questions, and again, we'll publish those on our website, www.ykchamber.com. So for question one, candidates will speak in the following order. We'll start with Terry, Josh, Chris, Steve, Mark, and Julian. For question two, Romel, Shauna, Stacy, William, Niels, John, and Robin. For the third and succeeding questions, we will announce which candidate will speak first. Our goal is to provide every candidate with an opportunity to be the first person to answer a question. The speaking order will never change, and we will continue going back and forth between the rows of candidates. Each candidate will have 2 minutes to answer their question. The timer will begin when the candidate starts speaking. When the candidate has 30 seconds left, you'll be notified by the raising of an orange piece of paper, and we'll ring a bell when time's up. Again, four questions have been prepared by the Yellowknife Chamber of Commerce. Afterwards, we'll accept questions from the audience. And if you wish to ask a question to the candidates, we ask that you approach the microphone, identify yourself, and present your question. Our microphone will be floating around, so we will come to you. We will not accept questions that are deemed inappropriate, offensive, or derogatory, and only business-related questions will be accepted from the audience. We will not permit members of the public to unreasonably attempt to use the question period as a platform for expressing a point of view on any issue. You have 1 minute to voice your question, so please keep the preamble short. If these rules are broken, we will ring our bell, we'll rule out of order, and we'll move to the next audience member who wants to ask a question. From the candidates, we expect the highest level of professionalism and respect. This means that when the bell rings to indicate your speaking time is over, you stop talking. And interrupting candidates while they're speaking is strictly prohibited. We will also not tolerate distracting behavior like hand signals or the use of props. If these rules are broken, again, we'll ring the bell, rule out of order, and provide a warning. If the rules are broken a second time, the candidate will be asked to leave the forum. Don't break the rules. Yellowknife is fortunate to have so many candidates running for council. The Yellowknife Chamber of Commerce is a nonpartisan organization and does not publicly support or endorse any political candidates. We wish everyone success and look forward to working with whoever is elected. We're going to start by giving each of our candidates, all 13 of you, 1 minute to introduce yourselves. So please tell us your name, your profession, and one key priority from your platform. We'll start with you, Terry.
I think I drew the short straw by starting, but anyways. My name is Terry Testhart. I'm running mainly because I have a lot of experience with municipal governments as a municipal administrator. I've been an SAO and hamlet manager in Vetchico, Tuktoyaktuk Enterprise, and a town manager for Inuvik for a short time. I am very interested in improving life in the city of Yellowknife. I want to assist council in anything I can with the experience I've had with governance and with transparency. We want to have an accountable council. We want to be transparent. I just said that, and I think I can help council on that level. Thank you.
Check 1, 2. Oh, there we go. Good evening. I'm Josh Campbell.
You're listening to CJCD. No. I moved here in 2007 when our city was seeing record growth. We were rocking the charts when it came to GDP. Our two diamond mines were not even halfway yet in their life. I came up to work as a broadcaster, and I started my career at CJCD when it was still proudly locally owned by the Dent family, and then went into politics working with Dennis Bevington, our member of parliament, for 3.5 years. I'm no longer with the NDP. I'm back into journalism again and taking a break from that to run in this campaign. I've also worked with other politicians such as Norman Yakalaya and Chief Sangries and Chief Betsina of DLO and DETA. I'll keep it simple. I'll keep it to 3 things tonight. I think our city needs to get back to the basics: dogs, ditches, and dumps.
First, I'd like to thank everyone for coming out tonight. It's great to see the support that council's getting. My name's Chris Galander. I was born and raised here in Yellowknife. I'm an independent consultant with Investors Group downtown, so I'm a financial planner. I run the track and field meet here for the kids every summer. I do a lot of coaching and community work within Yellowknife. And my big focus on my platform is going to be for the economy and for supporting small business in Yellowknife. I have my business downtown in the downtown core. I relate to a lot of the needs of the people within that sector and a lot of business owners here in town, and I hope to bring that experience forward. Thank you.
Thank you for the opportunity to speak. My name is Steve Payne. I'm currently running on for a second term on council. I've been living here in Yellowknife for 23 years. I am a business owner in town. I guess I really can't say I'm on council anymore. It's borderline. And I teach at St. Pat's. So one big thing that I want to get across this next term is tourism. I think that we're at the cusp of a pretty exciting time and a transitional period. And I would also like to work on some affordable housing. I got a few ideas, and hopefully they come up tonight. Thank you.
Oh, thank you. Hi, my name is Mark Bogan. I've lived in this city for over 30 years. This is the city I call home and the city I love. I currently work as a community outreach coordinator under the auspices of the NWT Disabilities Council, and I'm also working as case management for the homeless, vulnerable homeless population at the center. One of the big things that I wish to accomplish as city councilor is to address some of the social problems we have in the Northwest Territories. We've got very high consumption of alcohol and drugs, domestic violence, obviously the homeless population. So where possible and where practical, I'd like to take these issues to the Justice and Social Service Committee at the GNWT, and I do a lot of research on how other cities and communities, countries are improving those problems, and where practical to find solutions. Thank you.
Hi everyone, thanks for coming out tonight. My name is Julian Morse. I've served on council for the past 3 years. The top item that I have in my platform is economic development and diversification. I think that Yellowknife is going to be entering a period where we're going to be facing significant economic challenges, and that conversation needs to be top of mind for voters and for candidates during the election. I think I've proven myself to be hardworking in my time on council. I've chaired 2 committees. One of which is the Post-Secondary Advisory Committee. I think I've worked well with colleagues and administration. I believe that stable, consistent governance is the key to success on council. I think the best leaders create an atmosphere where people can succeed and you're only as strong as your staff. I believe in prudent budgeting, focused on infrastructure, but also taking strategic risks, such as the university feasibility study, which I pioneered and got council to approve and now act as the chair on that committee. I think putting ideas like that, thank you.
Hello. Thanks for coming in, for everybody that took time to come and listen to us. I'm Romel Silverio. I am running for a second term. I came here in 1998 with an immigrant dream that could translate to a Canadian dream, which I'm a regular guy that work in the hospital as a janitor, work in the mines as a kitchen helper, but I believe with this education, furthering education, so I went back to Aurora College, and I'm a proud graduate from Aurora College as a registered nurse. From there, I walk on my journey, and I become a patient care coordinator right now in the hospital. So I hope that one of my platform is the affordability, the gap between affordable housing and the market housing. And thank you.
Good evening, and thanks to all of you for having an interest in local politics. It's certainly appreciated. So I'm Shauna Morgan. In addition to working on council this past term, I work with a small consulting firm called Planet North, supporting community planning in other communities in the territory. I teach piano lessons to people of all ages, but especially kids. And I'm an instructor with some outdoor adventure camps with children. And I also work as a builder at the Snow Castle. So I have a multifaceted work life here, which I enjoy. And so one aspect of my platform is I want to help us build a resilient economy. So that means being able to respond to shifts in the broader economy, moving beyond mining to diversify, and we're already starting that, but especially in terms of supporting tourism, supporting a post-secondary institution, and our budding northern arts, and especially our film industry. Thank you.
Hi, good evening. My name is Stacy Smith. I'm a born and raised Yellowknifer, and I'm an Indigenous from the Tsleil-Waututh territory. Having lived here my entire life, I believe I have a good background to give to the community. I am an entrepreneur, my business based downtown, so I see a lot of the social issues that plague Yellowknifers on a day-to-day basis. My main platform is revitalizing downtown. I've had major efforts in the downtown region for the past 2 years dealing with Festival on Franklin, spearheading these efforts, as well as within the mall that I'm in, I spearhead a lot of the events that we have there to ensure that our small businesses thrive. And with revitalizing downtown, it's not just a small issue, it's a lot of major issues that need to be addressed. One of them, definitely homelessness, tackling addictions, abuse. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. First of all, thanks for coming here. I know everybody's valuable time. My name is William Gomes. I'm an accountant. I have been living here for the last 8 years and working for the territorial government as an accountant, budget analyst, for the last 8 years. My total background is accounting. I have been serving this community by providing tax services for many people, so I know many faces here. My core responsibility that I would like to accept, oversee the financial part of the city, apart from what I'm hearing from people, and I would like to work with your values, your voice, your concern. And that was my campaign platform to everybody when I was doing my homework, and I still want to go with that, and I did make my list. I hope I'm going to get some questions out of those topics, and pretty much willing to share my concern during my question period. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Niels Konga. I'm a father, a husband, and a business owner here in Yellowknife, running for my third term on council. I'm running again because 6 years ago when I ran, I wanted to get a departmental review on planning and lands, and that finally happened in the second term, and now going into what is hopefully a third term, we're going to implement some of the recommendations that came through that review. That's why I'm running again, and if you vote for me again, you can expect a whole lot more of the same as what you've seen in the last 6 years.
Hi, I'm John Dalton. I came here in 1972 with my wife. We had three children. I have seven grandchildren, and everyone still lives here. I want to be part of the solution. I want to see action, not studies. I'm willing to be an active voice on housing, electricity, governance, planning, budgets, and safe streets, to only name a few. And I want to try and bring some respect back for council by earning it. And that means working with you. Thank you.
Nanu Nanu. I'm Robin Williams, and I'm running for council. I'm a partner in Roy's Audio Video, downtown business. I'm going to keep it sweet because I'm last. You guys have been listening to us for a little while. I would like to thank you all for coming. And I'm a father of two. My platform focuses on economic development. I think it's time to promote infrastructure investment in this town as well. The time for tourism is now. Thank you.
Today we have 13 candidates with us, and we're going to start with four questions from the Yellowknife Chamber, and then we'll move into questions from the
thank
audience.
Thank you to all the candidates for introducing yourselves and for coming out this evening. If Deneen didn't mention, I'm Kyle Thomas, the first vice president of the Yellowknife Chamber of Commerce, and I get to ask some of the questions that we have prepared for the councillors or candidates this evening. Just as a reminder, we're going to be starting with the first row, which is the upper row, and we're actually going to start again with Terry, and we'll get right into it. A reminder that each councillor or candidate has 2 minutes to respond, at which point a bell will ring again. Our first question of the evening is, without discussing the obvious need for a visitor information service center and the city's efforts to establish a destination marketing organization, including the changes to the Accommodation Levy Act, or the implementation of Accommodation Levy, what will you do to make Yellowknife a more tourist-friendly community?
I think the key to making Yellowknife a more tourist-friendly community would be to provide a balanced, service-friendly community in the downtown area. The one of the problems with the downtown area is that there's many vacancies in the community and in the offices, in the stores, and it makes tourists a little bit uncomfortable and looking for a place to go, of which there is nothing in the downtown core itself. I believe that the council should be working with strategic partners in both the business sector and the property owners to develop a strategy for downtown, which would include building a visitor center right in the core. And I would put that together with a conference center to bring some life back into the city, have the tourists want to come here. There needs to be some self-promotion of Yellowknife in the tourism center itself, and the city could take an active role in lobbying the GNWT for funding, specifically with ITI, to promote Yellowknife as a destination place to come. Thank you.
On the clock. Once again, I'm Josh Campbell, and I worked in tourism in New Brunswick, a province that has become a bit of a have-not province and became a bit of a drive-through province. We don't have to worry about those issues up here being a drive-through territory, not yet until that Mackenzie Highway is built. But anyhow, I'll bring it back to my three things I said before: dogs, ditches, and dumps. And I want to say first and foremost, unlike the previous council, I would have had a different approach to Cam Lake. And that comes to the mushers and the dogs in my platform. I'm very happy to say that I have the endorsement of Beck's Kennels and the Mushing community. And they're the ones who built Yellowknife, the prospectors, the trappers, our first explorers that came here to work with the Dene. So I'm totally on board with those families and the Mushing community. How the Cam Lake thing's been handled is terrible, but I'll get back on topic here. Tourism, it's great. We got to invest everything we have in this sector. I walk downtown, I live downtown, and that empty mall owned by absentee landlords is a disgrace. It's terrible. Is this Prince Edward Island? We got absentee landlords in this territory? Let's get some ownership here in town. As I said before, I worked at CJCD. It was locally owned. And I think the commercials and the content made a lot more sense than it does today by Vista, wherever they're located, BC or somewhere. I'm here. I've been here for 10 years. I'm going to be here till I die. So let's get back on track. Airbnb, this is a hot topic. Victoria has a bylaw in place I think Yellowknife should look at. And that's how we regulate that. I'm not for too much government regulation, but Airbnb, it affects our, not so much the hotels, but it does affect our bread and breakfast, the mom and pop shops. We need to do everything we can do to support small business and bring more tourists in here. My centerpiece, my big idea, it doesn't come from the city, it comes from working with the federal government and the territorial government. Let's expand the runway and get big planes in here. Thank you.
First off, thank you, Kyle, for the question. I have been speaking a lot with departments in the GNWT, like ITI. One of the biggest things they say on the tourism side of it is that we're getting away from the Japanese tourists and we're getting more into the Chinese tourists. Now, they've been looking at the feedback as to what these Chinese tourists have been saying, and the biggest feedback they've got is we want to spend more money. Now, that should be like a complete green light for Yellowknife to go forward with this, but we don't have anywhere for them to be spending money, right? I would like to personally try to take a little bit different of approach. I would like to see the downtown core revitalized. I'd like to see Center Square Mall flourish like it did when I was a kid. But I think we should look at more hybridization of the residential and the commercial. Kind of like what you see where Gaia Clinic is behind the old Shoppers building. You can tell I'm an old Yellowknife, or I don't even know the street name, behind the old Shoppers. I would like to see that, because as someone who pays rent downtown and rent for housing, I'm basically paying the equivalent financially of having 1.5 to 2 mortgages. Well, for a startup small business, that isn't realistic. We can't be having these people take that much risk on while they're trying to implement new development downtown. So that's why I think hybridizing something where they could live out of where they're actually working, have one mortgage, have one asset. At the end of the day, if the company doesn't get off the ground, isn't as successful as they would have liked, they're still not out the rent they would have had in that commercial lease, wherever it might be, downtown, Cam Lake. So that's all I have to say on that. Thank you very much.
Thank you for the question. In regards to our visitor center, I think that there's a lot more ideas that we can probably focus on. I'd love to see some sort of cooperative avenue with the tourism companies in town. You know, they run the tourism center and possibly, and book all their tours through that, right? They share cost and there's more money being put into the economy. I'd love to see a better relationship between Yellowknife and YKDFN and communities like Bechco. I think we're missing the mark up here, and it goes right back to one of the previous speakers had said, we need more things for people to do when they're here, and it's not just for Chinese tourists or Japanese tourists. I mean, maybe the next group of people that we're going to be trying to advertise to are Germans or Brazilians or whoever, right? And we have 30 million people right in this country, and a lot of tourism has been happening from right at home here. So it'd be nice to have some more cultural tourism. We have the benefit of having, the Tlicho people, and we have the Dene, and it's an absolutely beautiful culture, and we need to develop relationships with the communities so they can share their culture. I know in my home province of Newfoundland, we have in the northern part, we have the Viking, Niels's background here with the Viking tourist attraction. And we actually have a working village there called Norsted. And right away you have people working, you have people sharing their culture. So I'd love to see something like that, Airbnb. I'd like to see a bit more rules and regulations around it. But then for bed and breakfasts, a bit less.
Hello again. Well, I went to the mayoral forums, and so I guess the first thing I would do is they had some great ideas regarding tourism, so I would certainly hold them accountable. Tourism is very important for the North, so I would look forward to working with Maggie Mercury and the YK Dene. I think that we need more indigenous lodges on maybe the North Arm and Dry Bones Bay area. Would attract some tourism, support our events. I think that we really need to take a look at the social problems downtown. We do have very high drug and alcohol consumption rates here in the Northwest Territories, yet we lack a proper wellness treatment center for the addict, for the addicted. So that would, it's another pitch that I would make to the Justice and Social Service Committee at the GNWT, maybe start small with 6 beds and do a review on its successes. Social media would play a big part in attracting tourism around the world. I certainly support the Dogs Trotters Association quest for land. The hotel tax levy would help. There seems to be a lot of support for that. Again, tourism is extremely important to the North. I'm definitely into increasing recreational activities for our families and people visiting, and better educating our children as to the negative effects of drugs and alcohol so that they can grow up and be healthy and wise. As to the rest of it, I think I just would really hold some of the promises made by our mayors that are going for election and hold them accountable. And that's about it. Thank you. Oh, by the way, I forgot to mention, I've got pamphlets and flyers over at the table there, so help yourselves. Thanks.
Thank you very much for the question. I especially appreciate the way that you framed it, because we have made a huge amount of progress on destination marketing, and I think where we need to turn our attention now is the tourist experience. I think that some of the answers are dead simple. One of them I would point out is signage. We don't have wayfinding signage. Wayfinding signage is signage that lets you know where you're going around town in Chinese and Japanese. And I think that little things like that make a huge difference. You see people wandering around town, not really knowing where they're going. Give them signage to let them know where the different things are. One initiative that I led with the Heritage Committee that's going to be coming to fruition in the next year is a project that we worked on in conjunction with YKDFN to recognize a number of Yellowknives Dene heritage sites around the city. And there's going to be a public art installation near Pilots Monument related to that. So public art, signage, interpretive signage, letting people know what they're looking at around the city, I think is important. So that's really simple. I really appreciate the answers of the speakers before me. I think that building partnerships with our neighboring First Nations is incredibly important. There's a huge potential here for cultural and ecotourism, and we've barely scratched the surface. And we held meetings over the past term with the community government of Bechico, with YKDFN, and that was one of the top topics that we talked about, was that we need to build the capacity of this region and start to turn ourselves into a region that people visit, so that they're going for longer trips and not just visiting for a couple days. The last point I'd make is that we need to work with the chamber. I think that a message that was brought to us by the chamber the last time we met was that we need to work with businesses to start to build the capacity of business in this town to receive tourists. Again, we're just starting to scratch the surface of this industry, and as Robin pointed out, the time is now to take action, so it's time for us to act. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, candidates, for that first round of questions and answers. This is just a reminder that for those candidates that didn't answer that question, you can submit a written response to that question. We will publish it online and push it out through our social media channels. So at this point, we're going to go down to the second row, the front row, and this is your question, your first question. The city's 2019 budget will be one of your first major tasks as a newly elected council. What are your budget priorities and your thoughts on property tax? And we're going to start with Romel for that one.
Always good to be first. So in terms of the property tax, I know that, most of the people sometimes decides to move away in Yellowknife because of so much property that the taxation here is, they keep saying that's going high. To me, as much as I am fine with the zero increase tax, but that's not possible. You know, working on 3 years in the council, it seems like, you know, we needed to have expenditures, you know, we need to build roads and all that. So to me, small incremental increases would suffice, not too much high though. And I mean, we can always use to point out the user's fee as well. I think that we can increase that, but there's also suggestions for flex pricing when they are on their downtimes and low times. I would like to see, because on next year, 2019, we will have the general assessment taxation again. So I'm hoping that for the business sector, they're able to go back to the pre-2014 when they decided to make those mill rate ratio imbalance. I want to see that to go back. And I think next year would be the best time to do it. So if you guys will be give me the chance to go back, I will be one of those people pushing back to those so that we can have a break for the business sector. Thank you.
Thank you for the question. I know property tax is always high on everyone's mind, and certainly cost of living is a concern. We hear this all the time. We know how important it is to people and how important it is to keeping residents staying here in town and businesses operating and open. So certainly I have done my best while scrutinizing each budget each year and making sure we're trying to focus on things that are absolutely essential for the city and that keep this city sustainable and are forward-looking, that we're taking care of our assets. We're not letting things crumble around us. And I think we have done a good job in the past 3 years of keeping property taxes either zero or quite low. So I think we've heard that message loud and clear. I do think, though, that we need to go into a budget knowing what our strategic priorities are. And so once council gets formed, one of the first things that we do is we get together, we have an orientation, and then we'll be trying to figure out what do we want to focus on? Because, you know, all kinds of ideas come out, and if we're constantly just reacting to one idea after another, and we haven't decided what our focus is, then I think we get scattered and we can start spending all kinds of things in every direction. Certainly one big item that we're hoping to move forward with in 2019 is the new aquatic center. And I've certainly heard there's a lot of support for that in this community. We did a survey, and there's out of families that responded to the survey, 77% of families, you know, are using the pool. So that's a big percentage of people in this community. And so that's the big infrastructure project that we're looking at going forward, and there's a lot of work underway. Other than that,
Hi, thank you guys for the question. So going around door to door,
I was able to grasp from people the needs. Going into 2019 with the budget, it will be very interesting because we'll have a new council, some old, some new, to collaborate on this. And definitely with the push now for tourism, it's going to be very important to consider what our budget is going to be for. Just like Shauna had said, we really need to focus on what it is that we're going to be striving for to indicate where our budget's going to lay. In terms of property taxes, as a property owner and also as a business owner, I do kind of feel that being in the position that I'm at, that I'm in, I'm able to pay said property taxes because they go towards funding certain items such as having an aquatic center or building towards an aquatic center. Some of the other things that have been brought up are definitely cost of living for individuals. I've spoken to quite a few people that are, I was actually at Native Women's today talking to them, and for those people who they don't have a high income, they do find it a struggle to try and find the money to be able to have their child go to the pool or go to the field house. So being able to be flexible on the user fees for these facilities would be very beneficial. In the next little while here, definitely the budget is going to definitely go towards tourism, which is in turn going to again help with revitalizing Yellowknife downtown. Thank you.
Thanks for the question. Budget priority, definitely. First of all, I need to look at the budget, and I would like to work within the budget that we have. Because as you see, in Canada right now, if you don't know, in the month of August, our inflation rate was 4.8%, which I never seen before, and I was very surprised when I was doing my homework. At this point, in terms of increasing taxes, my salary or your salary is not going up at this point. Government is barely matching the inflation, which is even not matching this at this point of time. So in order to increase the, to build a sustainable community, we need the people to, within our system, and we cannot, because when I was going door to door, people are saying about the cost of living, we cannot, instead of decreasing the cost of living, we cannot increase the cost of living at this point. And my focus would be like just work within the amount that we have as on our budget. And if there is something that we need to lobbying for more money, I would like to collaborate more with my partners, the all community governments, the federal and territorial governments, to see if we can find more money to do a little bit of more development in many sectors that Shauna and Stacy mentioned about. As you know, country as a whole at this point, we are really under a great depression right now, like under a great financial distress. And let's start the change from the small community so that we don't have to borrow money, we don't have to get increase our taxes at this point. Let this crucial time be over and then focus on stuff and issues that we can actually address, because City of Yellowknife has many other. Okay, thank you.
Thanks. Property taxes. Property taxes are really only one side of the equation that you have to look at when you're a councillor, in my opinion. There's also user fees, and you know, currently user fees for our facilities, rinks, pools, those sorts of things, they go up by 3% a year, and that is a number that was decided upon, I believe, back in the late 2008-2009. So every year you've seen a 3% increase in a lot of those user fees, and personally I don't think that is really the right way to look at it, just an arbitrary 3% increase on user fees a year for those type of facilities. I think that this council has made some strides in getting administration to show us, you know, what these actual costs are for user fees. And with that, you know, the taxes as well. You know, we're getting more information about, you know, the vehicles that we're replacing. And you go into a budget and you have to ask a lot of different questions. I do think, you know, my track record, I've voted no for some budgets because I felt that we could have done better. I plan on continuing to do that, but I mean, let's be frank here, we are looking at a possibly almost $60 million aquatic center for the city. And if we think we're gonna be able to do that without tax increases, we've got our head in the sand. So we're gonna see some tax increases if we want to have an aquatic center. But with the aquatic center and the user fees, I think that we can do our best to keep them at a minimum. And you know, there are some other things that we can do, reorganizing departments and you know, seeing if we can get some efficiencies in how we do our business at the city.
There's two issues under taxes, commercial and property, and I think they both have to be looked at and recognize that they are different. And look at what we've done in the past. Commercial taxes have increased more than property taxes. So we've got to find a balance. We have to have a vision and a priority of where we want to go. When we have our priorities established, then we can really set a budget that's realistic and and keep it in focus. We'll be faced with looking at the previous council's priorities. I don't know that I agree with all of those. We have to look at downloading, and we can't take on more than we can afford. And I think we have to revisit those issues where we're paying for things that should be sent on to the territorial government or to even the regions. We wrote off $300,000 worth of ambulance services, and a lot of that ambulance services were for people from outside and not Yellowknife residents. So there are things to look at and what we can do. But we've got to look at how we deal with the issues. The center, Yellowknife Center, is our key focus for most of the commercial. It is expanding, but we are losing property taxes and so on buildings and that are empty. And we cannot allow property to remain vacant and not developed. So we have to look at that issues. The priorities are what is going to have to be established, reaffirmed, and that is really what focuses your budget. And I don't think council has done a good job of that over the years, and I want to spend the time and properly have discussions on the priorities.
Great, thank you for the question. So first off, when it comes to budget priorities, I'm going to be focused on infrastructure spending. So if it's an initiative that comes along with a piece of infrastructure, that's something that I'm going to be for. I think infrastructure draws new residents and it keeps the ones that we already have. Specifically on that front, you know, as some of the other members have mentioned, pool, I think that should be top of the list. It is top of the list. Visitor center and fleshing that out in what that idea could be. I think also what Julian had touched on with signage is so important for us to develop as a tourism leader in the north. I also think mechanisms or facilities such as indoor aurora viewing, those types of things should be encouraged from planning and lands and having businesses come up and invest there. Now, as far as taxation goes, I'm always for taxing the individual less. People talk about the cost of living here. Well, my property tax at home is higher than my power bill and it's higher than my heat bill. And people talk about power bills all the time and my power bill is nowhere close to my property tax bill. So as a first-time councillor, I'm not gonna go in there blazing and cutting taxes, but it's definitely gonna be something I wanna look at. I think we should be more creative. I think we have a tourism levy coming on. I think the GNWT has allowed us to charge up to 4% for visitors. I think we should be maximizing that. I also think that we should be using that monies for development of infrastructure that's related to tourism here in town. They talk a lot about destination marketing. Destination marketing is great, but we also need to have infrastructure here for the visitors when they do come and visit Yellowknife. Thanks very much.
Thank you, candidates, for answering that question. Just as a reminder that you don't need to be as close to the microphone as you might think. It was a message passed on, so just to be aware for everyone. We're going to go back up to the first row. So, thanks, Steve. To the first row, we're actually going to start with Steve this time, and we'll go over to Julian and then back to Terry to finish with Chris. So the third question we have for this evening is, in a 2014 report, the GNWT concluded that it is underfunding community governments by a total of $40 million annually. This includes the city of Yellowknife, which the GNWT underfunds by $11.4 million each year. What steps will you take to ensure that this funding gap is closed?
What steps to close it? That's a tough one. I appreciate you letting me go first on this one, really. I mean, with the exception of threatening and saying, you better pay us our money or I'm gonna beat you up. You know, we can lobby the government. That's a tough one. We've been asking for our $11.4 million for the last few years, and we've gotten very little back from it. So we keep asking, we call them out, make them feel bad. But really, I have no idea how to get that $11.4 million. I mean, we can, yeah, that's a tough one. Like, people smarter than me have been trying for the last couple of years and they've done shit. So I'm, thank you.
Follow it up, Mark.
Okay. So what? Where do we get $11 million out of the next premier? Well, stop voting for them. We can encourage all constituents to re-elect new members. You know, we can panhandle, I guess. Maybe appear before a committee and beg. You know, they're set in their ways, and it's tough to get $11.4 million out of the GNWT for much of anything on the best of days, let alone the city of Yellowknife. So I'm kind of with Steve on this one. Lobby, beg, borrow, you know, don't vote for them. Maybe we'll have better luck with the next assembly. I'm lost on this one. Thanks.
Thank you very much for the question. Like my colleagues, I will say this is a tough one. However, there are steps that we can take. I mean, it was the NWT Association of Communities that first brought this issue forward, and I think working with them on lobbying is certainly an important one. I also think this is a great question for MLAs to ask them, and you know, I know that we have an MLA in the audience, so I'm gonna single you out, Corey, and just say, feel free to ask Mr. Van Thine about this one when you're on your way out the door tonight. no, but seriously speaking, I mean, we need to recognize too that the territorial government is also facing a crunch, same as the city is. And, you know, what happens to the territorial government's finances affect people in this city just as much as anyone else. Close to 50% of the population of this territory lives in this city. So it certainly won't do us any good if the territory bankrupts itself, giving us money. I mean, you're talking about, I forget what the saying is there, but I think it's something that we're going to address the issue over time. I think it's going to happen incrementally. Certainly they're not going to start. And keep in mind here, we're not talking about $11.4 million. We're talking about $11.4 million annually. That's a lot of money. And so I think that the best approach that we can do here is to continue to lobby our colleagues. We know that they're in a tight spot, but so are we. And certainly the municipality can make good use of that money to invest in infrastructure. So I think that, you know, lobbying for an incremental approach. You know, one small achievement that I would point out is during our last budgeting session, we identified that the territorial government pays for ambulance fees for communities around the territory, whereas Yellowknife charges that out, as was mentioned by Mr. Dalton. We actually implemented a program to significantly increase the fees that we're charging the territorial government over time. And so again, an incremental approach, but that's going to result in us not losing nearly as much money to the ambulance service that we do on their behalf. So there's one thing.
This is a subject that I'm quite familiar with. The Julian's right in that the, in my opinion, the city should strongly lobby the NWT Association of Municipalities to get some more fairness in the formula funding that the city gets, like all the municipalities in the north. There's a shortfall in operating money and capital money for every community, especially in infrastructure. There's a large infrastructure shortfall that NWT Association of Municipalities has identified quite clearly. But the there's specific funding that is, it's a funding in grants for operations and maintenance, for water, sewer, and for capital. And on a per capita basis, the larger communities like Yellowknife, but all the tax-based communities like Hay River and Newvik, Fort Smith, even Norman Wells, they're underfunded compared to the smaller municipalities. So it's a difficult topic to raise with the MLAs about the unfairness in the community grants, but I think the city has to do that. It's got to approach individual MLAs, especially the ones in Yellowknife, and it's got to lobby hard with the NWT Association of Communities to get a fair funding. The other funding that the city could be lobbying for is a share of the royalties from the mining. Thank you.
I'm, too loud. I'm going to follow Steve Payne's example and throw in one of my East Coast lines too. It's a piss poor deal. $11 million a year, that's pretty much half of the 2018, $26 million capital budget. $11 million, that could build a pool that a lot of parents and families want. But how would I tackle it without swearing and being immature? One way of doing it through my activist roots would do a roadblock the ledge. We'll put a public works truck across it and let the MLAs get to session. That's one clear way of doing it. Terry's got a wealth of knowledge in communities. I'm also well known in the Klitschko Nation. And just to put it into perspective, those are four communities. Betcheco is the largest. Guess what? They only get a fourth of the budget. They don't get the biggest share. Most of the Klitschko citizens live in Betcheco. So just to give you an example, there's other communities that are going through this big time, shortfalls. So we got to come up with $11 million. Sit on our thumbs. We got to get it. I'll do everything I can to get it. I know the mayor of Iqaluit, Mayor Redfern. I know Dan Curtis very well. I lived in Whitehorse for 5 months. I'll get some pointers from them on how they get $11 million bucks in their territorial governments. Also, as Julian pointed out, and Terry as well, I don't want to be copying, but it's exactly that. It's the NWTAC. We have to work with the NWTAC. I know several former presidents of the NWTAC and some other mayors up and down the valley here the mayor of the new highway, Mr. Mervyn Grubin. So we'll work with the other mayors on this, the other councils on this, because it's not just a Yellowknife issue. If we're getting $1 million shortfall, just imagine what the shortfall is in Ulahuktuk and the other communities. Thank you.
All right, I will start by thanking you for the question, Kyle. I think I should thank you for that question. So outside of lobbying, I think that we can start to develop tighter relationships with all levels of government. So this is going to be the GNWT. It's also going to be the federal government. Personally, that's the type of relationships that I want to establish if and when I'm on council. But besides that answer, I think we're really looking at a question of a deficit here. If there's no way that we can look into where we can get this funding, we still have a deficit that we need to recoup. So that means we have to take a look at our own house and try to nickel and dime our budget to see how much of it we can create ourselves. So I'm going to take a look at the budget, go through it, obviously, with whatever new council would be, and see where we can make up that ourselves, as it doesn't seem we've been making any headway with any of the other jurisdictions. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you all for tackling that question that I threw out there. To follow the format that we have here, we got to stay on schedule, but you're welcome to submit your responses and we will publish them online. Just for reference, this is an advocacy mission that the Chamber has recently taken on. We did submit a letter to the City Council and to the GNWT, so everyone mentioned NWTAC. This is also an opportunity for everyone to partner with the Chamber. We're going to jump down to the second row and keep on with my final question of the evening before we open it up to the floor. For this question, we will be starting with William. And the question is not as many numbers as that past one. As a city councillor, how will you make Yellowknife a more attractive place for business investment? We'll start with William.
Can you repeat the question one more time, please?
Oops, got to turn my own mic on. Could you, there's a request that you introduce yourself, just your name quickly when you begin speaking, just for reference for everyone.
Sure.
As a city councillor, how will you make Yellowknife a more attractive place for business investment?
William Gomes. My name is William Gomes. Sorry, that's another tough question, of course. I was kind of going to relate that question with the first one that we had today about that tourist industry. Well, first of all, you know, in downtown area, we have some areas where we can develop our construction and attract more people. We have to open up some places. We have to open up some venues where we can give opportunity to the people to open their businesses. In this town, like what I heard from, like, and what when I was doing my homework, definitely people, our tourists are like, thank you very much, all the partners in government, that we brought in $200 million last year from the tourist industry alone. And this is kind of a light that you can see when our mining industry actually is in uncertainty right now. Definitely one of the area that I would like to see improvement, since the money is kind of coming from the tourist industry, I want to make sure that our tourist feels really safe in downtown core. And this is one of the biggest concerns that I'm receiving from the partners, like the private sector partners and other sectors. And also, I want to emphasize more on the tourists, because we need to put some frontline workforce with more knowledgeable about our heritage, our culture, and our natural beauty here. And also, I would like to see our tourist information center is kind of meeting the needs that our current tourists requires. Thank you.
Thank you, Niels Konga. I'm going to start by answering or say what I would have said at the last one. The underfunding issue, as a city council, we need to stop paying for things that the GNWT should be paying for. That's in the budget. On to this question, more attractive for business investment. There's a few things that I think that the city should be doing. We need to be getting access to more land. Currently, when the city makes an application to the GNWT for land, we typically get, maybe if we're lucky, 10% of what we're asking for. And that really hampers what we can do in terms of development, whether that be for Aurora viewing. I know that's a current topic that's out there. The Aurora operators would like to have some land where they can put up some Aurora viewing tents and that are domes. So we need to lobby the GNWT and get more land so that we have a little bit more control over our own development. The other thing that I think the council needs to do is to direct administration to create a permitting division at the City of Yellowknife. Right now, if you go in for a permit, you want to build something, you go to planning and lands, then you go to building inspections and public works, and then you also have to go to the GNWT. So I think we should have a permitting division where when you come to the city and you want to do something, you go to one person, that person basically is an ambassador for you, they carry you throughout the whole process. That would make it a lot easier for people to get things done in the city. Things that we're doing right, I mean the GNWT, we have low business tax, that's a good thing. Things that we're doing wrong, the City of Yellowknife has two main mill rates on property tax. The commercial mill rate on property tax is double that of residential, and I think that we need to look at that split and see how we can sort of level that playing field out to attract more business development. Thank you.
Commercial or residential, both ways to bring in investment. We could look and work with the Capital City site and see about getting that road built on the other side and building residential areas over the other side that would both build infrastructure and investment in the community. We have to also go out and market Yellowknife. We don't market the city well. Hay River does a far better job than we do. We have to be our service approach has to improve. As Neil said, find a way to make it easy to approach council and its administration to develop. Right now it's a nightmare and it's a deterrent for anyone to wanting to go either build a home or build a business. We have to solve the downtown. And by doing that, we have to look at a multiple approach. We have to have some place where people can feel safe in. Right now, our community, our own citizens don't feel safe, and we won't be able to attract anyone into the city for development unless we do. We have the DND coming in with a large operation. We have to look and have some discussion to them and say, what other opportunities can we do? We have to build on what we have. We have to find a way for Blanca Development to look at filling in the Blanca building. It's been sitting vacant for a long time now. We have to utilize every single opportunity to promote Yellowknife. And I said before, we have to stop the territorial government downloading, because that takes away from Yellowknife and the viability and economic issues that people have to cost of living here. We have to renegotiate our electrical and keep the cost low.
Hi there, thanks so much for the question.
So I look at businesses as sort of three sectors, or small businesses, medium businesses, and large businesses. Not all of them are the same, and not all of them have the same concerns. I think for small businesses, I think we need to revise, well, we're currently revising, but we need to revise and promote the business licensing procedure and create opportunities for residents and short-term rentals. I would say home-based businesses should be expanded. Also, there's a growing do-it-yourself and sharing economy businesses that many people have started to see emerge online, Etsy's, so to speak, those types of things. For medium businesses, I really think that we should invest in tourism. Medium businesses are going to benefit from more foot traffic in our town, and the more that we can do to promote foot traffic for businesses, the better they'll do. For large businesses, I think that we should start discussions on vacancy taxation models. I know a couple candidates have pitched these ideas. I think it's a way to motivate landowners to free up some of the assets that they have. I'm a big believer in, I think it's great that they have these holdings, but use them, renovate them, make them relevant to today's businesses, or sell them and allow bigger players to come in or local players to come in and make some effects there. Now, just to touch on a couple of things, just for that small businesses, much like what Niels was talking about, having business license ambassadors. Those are a great resource for people that maybe aren't business-minded but more arts-minded to get a shingle up and get a door open. I also think that looking at taxation for large businesses is something that we need to do. Mill rates changed as a result of the mines leaving town. We need to readjust because they're not coming back. unless there's Terra X back there makes a go of it, which we hope they do. Thanks very much.
Romel Silverio. First thing is that we want to have a, you know, in terms of power rates, you know, as other people mentioned, we have an opportunity next year to renegotiate the power rates. So there's an opportunity for us to see if we can save money from that. Again, if the Telstra expansion is coming, I will be in support in that if I'll be in the council. And, you know, again, 2019 general taxation assessment, you know, we need to push that and make sure that the mill rates will go back to the same as before to give fairness to everybody. I mean, you know, downtown, we need to do more. Although the council, the present council did a lot of job in downtown, I think we still have more things to do there. You know, we need to continue address the social issue as they come out. You know, put patrols for MEDs or the RCMP. We need to put those so that people feel safe when they come, tourists, even the resident. And then again, it's business incubation. We need to think about that as well. And densification of the downtown as well, to have a mix between business and residential. I think if we can bring those two together, we can flourish. Thank you.
So it's Shauna Morgan here. So I definitely want the city to continue supporting locally owned businesses. I feel that they are the heart of the city. They're often very innovative and they make life better. Not only do they boost the economy, but they make life better for residents because there's more things to do, more restaurants to eat at, more interesting things to buy. And so one program that was very successful over the past couple of years has been Win Your Space Yellowknife, which is a program between the city and the Chamber of Commerce and a few others. And so it's a contest, and the winners are awarded a space downtown. And so in the past 2 years, 5 new businesses have actually started up downtown in various spaces that have won this contest, and many others have received support, mentorship, business development training, networking. So I think we should definitely continue on that. And in terms of downtown revitalization, so I think more people will be shopping downtown if there are more people living downtown. I think we can do more to encourage more residential development downtown.
And especially with the National Housing Strategy, there's money coming down the pipe, for example, for non-market housing, subsidized housing. So I think we need to grab hold of some opportunities there and work with the NWT Housing Corporation to ensure we have more housing units, especially downtown. Also, I think we've seen some success with the pop-up park this past year that took a lot that was empty downtown and invited lots of innovative and creative ideas, both from nonprofits and the business community. And I think we can do a lot more of that. I mean, it's called placemaking, but we can take lots and corners and neighborhoods in this town, encourage creativity, have more contests, challenge businesses and organizations to come up with ideas for what we can do with that space and just revitalize spaces.
I can work a microphone. I swear I can. All right. all right. So my name is Stacey Smith. So attracting for business investment. Being a small business owner, I've had a chance to go down to a lot of the businesses down on Franklin. And I know we're not the only businesses. I know there's lots of businesses out in Cam Lake that definitely are important to our economic growth. Because my main platform is definitely revitalizing downtown, there are a lot of vacant spaces. And the reason for that really is because the spaces that are available, they're dated for one, and they cost a horrendous amount of money to rent. So in order to be a small business and wanting to grow, you have to kind of weigh those things. Do I want to pay this much rent, and I don't know if this is going to work? It's really scary, and it's daunting for people who want to start up their own businesses. So I think it is on the city definitely to aid and discuss with some of these commercial owners a way in which they can subsidize the renting, even if it's just for a month or two before businesses can get underway and you know, get a good grasp of their niche. Really, what else do I have here? definitely restructuring, because the next goal is to go towards tourism. Tourism is going to be the next big boom for us. And really working with some of the outer communities, Bechacon, working with the YK DFN to really come in and bring in our cultural components so that their small businesses can work towards tourism. Tourists want to see trails, they want to see all these types of things, and who better to show them around than the local people. Thank you.
Thank you again to all the candidates for answering those questions. We're now going to move into the portion of the evening where we take audience questions. Jessica is just grabbing the microphone, and she will be coming around the room to those who raise their hand that have a question. Please be patient and identify with her that you have a question, and she'll make sure she keeps the order. When you're asking a question, we ask that it be business only or business related only. We are the Chamber of Commerce, so we want to make sure that we are using that platform properly, and we're going to limit questions to 1 minute. We were going to, again, these first question will be directed at the top row, and for this time we'll be starting with Mark. And then each counselor or candidate up there will have 2 minutes to respond. So.
Hi, I'm Lydia Bardak, and surprise, I actually have a business-related question, so I'll throw you all a curveball. I was thrilled in 1989 when I came here to find out all the dog mushing community that existed, and it's a little known fact, in 1994, I was the businessman's champion in the dog race, and so, as dog sledding is a huge and integral part of our local tourism, and for the sake of tourism, local history, and reconciliation, What will you do to secure permanent tenure to the dog mushing community who have invested 40 years of blood, sweat, and tears and trail development in the Cam Lake area? What will you do to permanently secure their tenure in that area and not have them living a few years at a time and having to be threatened constantly with relocation?
Thank you for the question, Lydia. I'm certainly in favor of recreational activities in town for our children and youth and families. I think I would continue to support their lease, absolutely. However, you know, we want them to be inclusive in the city and inclusive to the value that they bring for our tourism industry as well as our residents. So I'm in favor of them purchasing their lands, and I'm in favor of them expanding with any needed purchases in Cam Lake, and you know, so that they could continue to prosper and provide essential services for our youth, children, and families, and as well as a massive contribution to the tourism industry. Thank you.
Thanks very much for the question, Lydia. Yeah, this one was certainly one that the previous council faced, and as you know yourself, virtually everyone has in the past 30 years. Something that I would point out is that there's a lot to consider here, and one of them is that even if we do turn the current lot over to the dog trotters permanently, we're only beginning to address the problem, and that is that if you move to town right now and you want to get into dog mushing, or you're already into dog mushing, you want somewhere to keep your dogs, we have absolutely nothing to offer. As Councillor Conga rightfully pointed out, you know, the lack of land in this city is a major issue, and it affects the dog trotters just as much as it affects business and industry. You know, the thing is that the way the dog trotters are on the lot right now, I think that they would tell you that, you know, there's not enough space on that lot, and they've told us very clearly that they want to expand, you know, further into Cam Lake. So currently what we're doing right now is working on the general plan. And I think as part of that process, we need to consider dog mushing as one of the many needs that needs to be balanced as we plan how we're going to use the land that we do have and the land that we'd like to acquire into the future. Certainly, you know, in my time as a councillor, when that came forward to us, I said very clearly that I want us to negotiate fairly with the dog trotters. I still stand by that position. And I think that there's a lot that we need to figure out as we go through this. And that is that, you know, there's the current issue of the lot that exists, but there's also figuring out how we're going to work with them and get land into the future, because they want to grow their business. And certainly we want them growing their business as well. Like I mentioned earlier that, you know, cultural tourism is something that I'm interested in expanding here. Well, dog mushing is a huge part of that. And so they've contributed greatly to our economy. So I'm supportive of them.
Go ahead, Terry.
Thank you. Terry Testart. I'm one of the councillor hopefuls. I've been approached by one dog musher group and asked the direct question about whether I support them to keep their lot and retain tenure, and I said yes. I think the key to anything, any development, whether dog mushers or any other purpose, is the key to it is to have a consistent general plan and rules around that general plan. And I see a weakness in the city of having a general plan but not sticking to it. The dog mushers need a place to need land, as was said before, but there should be common sense rules with the dog mushers. There were areas in Engel District that dog mushers may have gone to, but in the plan it said that they could not have a residence on that land, and somebody's got to take care of dogs if they have a lot for dogs. So some of those rules don't make sense. So I believe that if I was elected to council, one of the main things I would do is bring consistency to the general plan, make regulations so that people do what they say that they're going to do with the lot, and that the rules around that land base be on a common sense approach. So if you have a use, you develop those uses. Make building permitting system easier, make it simpler, make sure that buildings are made to code. But I've talked to lots of the builders in the Cam Lake area, and they say building in Yellowknife is the hardest thing to do because of the permitting and the inspections. So in that, the dog mushers are part of that, and they need to have common sense approach to what they want to do. They want to have certainty on their land, and they should have it. Thank you.
The question I've been waiting all night for, all campaign for. I'm a zealot to this cause. Thank you for the question, Lydia. Thank you for years of service to City Council and to our less fortunate people that are also called a city home. Thank you. So without a doubt, if you believe in Facebook analytics, this is the one post I made on social media. Brendan Bell told me I'm a social media rock star. Thank you, Brendan. This is the main plank of my platform, because it ties into tourism, it ties into our history, and it ties into that last part of your question that no one else seemed to want to address, and I'll address it, not as a political buzzword. It really ticks me off when people do that. Reconciliation. This city has done some stuff, but we have a lot more to do, as with our country, Canada, when it comes to reconciliation. And this is the key plank of my platform. It's everything that I stand for and I love in this town, is dog mushing. I also got the email from the Dog Trotters Association, and I told them, I am disgusted with how the previous council dealt with this matter and sat on their hands and put it to administration. You elect us to make decisions and to listen to you, not to sit here and waver and say, oh, administration, will you do a study on this for us? No, you elect us to make a decision, and I'll do that. So I stand totally 110% behind the Dog Trotters Association, behind Beck Kennels, even behind Donnie Morin's. They do some dog mushing as well. When it comes to the question of land, it also ties back to reconciliation. We need to lobby the federal government and the GNWT to quit stalling and get the Acacho process finished. That will help the YKDFN, the mushers, and the city. So we're not living in a tin can and blaming everybody. We got to get a land claim done in this territory, Acacho territory, Chief Draggy's territory, so the city of Yellowknife can grow and prosper. Everybody can prosper. Thank you.
For those in the back, my name is Chris Galander. So thank you for the question, Lydia. This is a topic that I haven't had enough time to research as far as yet. But what I can tell you is that I do support the dog trotters in town. And I want to get onto council so that I can take a more informed opinion on this and see what we can do as far as working with you to find either a solution that can set you in stone where you are, or a solution that will still work for you. So my opinion right now is I don't want to come from a place of ignorance and give you an answer that I can't keep, but I do want to support you in every way I can, because I do feel that you're an important part of our community. And I'm looking forward to diving into this question a lot more and seeing what we can do to try to help you on it. Thank you very much.
I don't think we did a terrible job this last council. I think you need to relax a bit, man. You need to chill out. This was a tough one for everybody involved last year. I'm a big supporter of the mushers up here, and it's a big part of our tourism industry. And they're just good people that run these businesses. I don't want to see anybody not being able to continue on with this their love, their passion. You know, we have And I'm assuming it's majority, it's the Dog Trotters that you're talking about, right? The Dog Trotters Association. I think we should offer up that piece of property for them to buy. You know, I think that they've been given a raw deal over the last 40 years. They've had to move 3 times, and this was their supposed to be their forever home. And, you know, you get people complaining. The Dog Mushers have been there for 42 years, I believe it was. And they were there before Grace Lake development and before a lot of the homes that are there. And I don't know anybody on that water side of Grace Lake that gets upset every time they're sitting by their fire and they're looking out the window and seeing the dogs run by. You know, they're not saying, man, that sucks. You know, they're happy to see it. And it's bringing a lot of money into town. And it's giving something. This goes right to tourism. It's giving something for tourists to do. And the big part, I don't think that we should be moving them. They want to move up the lake a bit. First of all, it's going to keep their access to their existing trails. I mean, there's generations of people that have been working those trails. When we first came up here, one of the first things we did was we took a ride with the McQueens. You know, and I remember it like it was yesterday, and they're good people, and they got my support. Thank you.
Thank you, candidates, for that round of responses. We'll move on to the next audience question. And I can't actually see Jessica.
Hi, I'm Sue Glowich. I don't think there's a person in the room that would deny that it's very expensive to develop a property here. My question to you is twofold. Number one, do you see a business case for keeping green space in our town? And if you do think that it's a positive thing for business, how do you go about holding green space in Yellowknife?
So we'll be going to the front row for that. We're going to be starting with Robin this time.
Hi, Sue. Thanks for the question. First off, it's identifying those areas in the community plan we have coming up this year. Green spaces are an incredibly important part of a functioning residential neighborhood, even a downtown core. So I think that it's again, coming down to planning, identifying those areas that are important to Yellowknifers, identifying the areas that we have that has the most access and the best benefit for residents, and then sticking to plans. I think that's one of the themes that we've been hearing with these council, with these debates, is sticking to the plan and the zoning. So I'd be for identifying areas in a community plan, sticking to that plan, and having it benefit the majority of Yellowknifers. Thank you.
I don't think there's anywhere in town that's...
We come back to Ramel, and then we scoot along. So you're last, so you got lots of time, John.
Okay, thank you. I believe that we need to maintain that green space as well. I was just trying to remember if, because sometimes I know council will decide to convert some green space to a residential space. I think there's reason why we did that. But I know that, identifying the area, make sure that we are able to keep those areas as a green space. I believe that we needed to have that green space that we can use for our own leisure, so that we can go and visit parks and all that. That one also that attracts the tourists that they can go and see it. Again, as I said, maintain and make sure that we're keeping all those identified green spaces. Thank you.
Thank you for the question, Sue. So it's Shauna Morgan here. So in terms of a business case, I think I'm too close, for green space, I mean, certainly, I think it's a key part of what attracts tourists here. One of the unique things about Yellowknife is that we are, in many ways, a wilderness city. Tourists can explore trails,
go dog mushing, do all these things right from the city itself. And so that's one of our big selling points. But I think what we sometimes forget is that our green spaces around the city, there's also opportunities in them to offer services and programs for residents themselves. So for example, I work with the Bush Kids program, so that's like an outdoor education program with kids that come one day a week. And we do the program right in green spaces within the city. So behind the multiplex, there's an amazing green space where kids can run around and play in the forest, also behind the museum. So programs like this, we couldn't operate if there weren't green spaces that are close to schools, close to the city. Also, I think green space certainly has an impact on property values, but not just that, but the quality of life for residents. It makes it a place where people want to live, they want to stay, and certainly when there are green spaces that allow for trails, people can then commute to work, for example, along the Frame Lake Trail, they can get downtown. And so that is a huge boost to quality of life. And one of the unique parts of this city, you know, we don't live in a place where it takes an hour or 2 hours to commute to work every day in a car in traffic jams. You can go along a beautiful trail and get to work in quite a short amount of time. And so I think we can't underestimate what that contributes to people's quality of life. And just the amount of time and money and energy that saves people. Thank you.
Hi, Sue. It's Stacy. So green spaces. Growing up here my entire life, my entire backyard was a green space. I lived out in Conn prior to all of the new developments. So, I mean, I grew up running up on Tin Can Hill, scraping my knee, poking at beetles, all that good stuff. And going around talking with a lot of people, Tin Can Hill seems to be a place of interest. It's where you can walk your dog. It's where you can go for a little mini hike. I know I did a mountain biking course up in that area. So really revamping on the spaces that are most prominent for people that, you know, it's not quite in the wilderness, but it's in your backyard. You can go and play. In terms of business green spaces, I remember with the Greenstone building, the way in which it was supposed to actually be planned was the park was supposed to be facing Franklin Avenue rather than the other way around, but it went to the council and council decided to go against the planner's decisions and switch it around. So nobody knows really that green space is there because there's a huge building that's blocking it. So I mean, it could have been utilized, switched around, and it's a great place to go and have your lunch, to chill out for a bit. It would have been great. Still is a great spot, but people sometimes forget that it's there. Really, I think, again, being downtown, because that's where I work, really the only real lush green space that's close in the downtown core, because that's where a lot of business individuals work, would be City Hall. City Hall has a great park that's there, the Samba K Park, wonderful place to go, but I think we can definitely work on increasing the general splendor of what we do with our little patches of green that are within town.
William Gomes again. Thanks for the question. I would like to stay green in my mind and my heart. So definitely green is one of my favorite things that I would like to see in this town. And when I was doing the homework here, going door to door, definitely many people actually came with the same concern that they need to see a little bit more green space in downtown area. And at the same time, I actually did raise one of the concerns that, yes, definitely, it is easy that we can say, okay, we need these, we have so many demands, but we still need to focus on the cost that it will incur in order to build those green spaces. And if you look at this, like the last year, or in last 3-4 years, I think the wonderful addition was one of those addition was the Samba K Park. I really enjoy it. Like during my summer, I go there and enjoy my lunch. What I see right now, I think city is in a bit of a tight financial situation
to allocate more money to those O&M costs. Like it is easy to build, like one-time expenses, and we built it, but every year we have to put some money as an O&M cost to maintain those green spaces. It's not that I'm not supporting it. Definitely, as I said, I would like to stay green in my mind and heart. Definitely, I am a good supporter. I like to walk through those streets where I'm surrounded by green trees, green plants, green grasses, and especially, definitely the greenness increase this. Shauna mentioned that increase the quality of life, and I'm looking forward to see more greenness. Like if I'm elected or if those agenda comes forward, definitely I'll be a good, in my opinion, we should have a little bit more green spaces in downtown core, especially when we have, thank you.
Thanks for the question. Nils Konga here. So, you know, when the city or any private developer is doing planning on a new neighborhood, there are certain a formula that the city uses in what is required for green space. So if you take Block 501, which is the Lakeside Developments, I believe it is, out on Cam Lake Road, you know, there's a bunch of parks and there's a bunch of trails that were that the developer needed to develop when they did that neighborhood. So, you know, there are policies and procedures in place to ensure that we have green space in all new development. You know, in terms of green space, I think we should look at our trail system, and there is a trail accessibility study that I'm not sure if it's come to council yet. I don't think it has, but we need to look at that and how we can connect our trails. Now, one of the things that I like about being in Yellowknife is, you know, pretty much no matter where you are, if you go about 8 minutes in any direction on your snow machine, you are in the wilderness. You are in the middle of green space. So when I look at that and I look at, you know, the city and how the city needs to develop, if this question is specifically about Tin Can Hill, I think we need to, as a council, be cautious when we take, you know, because we have such a, you know, land is, we're surrounded by all this land, but we have very little land that the city has access to for development. And development can be very expensive as we go farther and farther away from the downtown. And Tin Can Hill is a huge swath of land that would be inexpensive to develop because the infrastructure is right there. So, you know, I think we need to have a holistic approach to green space, and we need to look at it with several lenses: the development lens, the quality of life lens, and just the common sense lens. Thank you.
John Dalton. I think any new development has to maintain green space, and we've done a pretty good job of that, I think, for the most part. We can develop some of the green space areas as to make it more usable, but there's areas of development where we really, I think, have failed in a little bit, and that's partly the new development out in Cam Lake. Everything was stripped off for the trailers, and it's vacant of trees except when you're right down near the lake. And I think that those sorts of approaches, I think we have to be careful about how we do it. But we are surrounded by green space. And the schools use the areas very effectively. I do believe that we should look at development because we need the development of a tax base, but we have to do it responsibly. I do like the thought of the other side of Frame Lake, behind the ledge and that area, to look at development. There's trails in through there, and they can all be kept and utilized and built so that people are built around the green space. And in fact, trails in are just literally entwined in and amongst, and we leave the trees and the structures. Tin Can Hill is something that's has been talked about for development. We don't have many areas in town, but what we do have is well used. Behind the community, the field house, there's excellent spaces back in there, and that's within. So I agree with green space, but we also have to be prudent as to where we go, but it cannot be ignored. Thank you.
Thank you, candidates. For this next audience questions, we're going to go back to the top row, and we'll start with Josh for this one.
Hi, everybody. Finally, I get a chance to ask a question. Thanks to everyone for stepping forward. Thanks for everyone for stepping forward for council. It takes a lot of guts to do what you're doing, and I think that we'll have a good working relationship should I be elected as the mayor. I'm wondering, considering that government runs on the idea that peace, order, and government, good government needs transparency in order to achieve efficiencies in relation to how it deals with business. How do you see a city cutting regulation and increasing transparency over the next council? Thank you.
Gerald, we need a question that is business related. Can you rephrase that to be business related?
Pardon me, with the idea, of course, that less regulation and more transparency increases and improves the business environment here in Yellowknife. Sorry, that's my added item. Is that fine?
We'll accept it.
Thank you.
Thanks, Gerald, for the question. I'm trying to think how to answer it to tie it into the business sling as well. I heard the POG clause. I haven't heard that since I was in university in political science class. Peace, order, and good government. That's what they call it, the POG clause. Pogging along here. Thanks to YK Chamber again for hosting this tonight. Great to see you all. I'm Josh Campbell. You probably know my voice. You don't know my face. We're talking transparency. It reminds me of the 2008 federal election, and it was the Conservatives' mantra, transparency, transparency. I think if I hold the paper up, is that a prop? Okay, I'll put the paper down. Anyways, the August 10th edition of Yellowknifer talks to this issue. It talks to a business owner that I know very well who had a conflict with bylaw over an alleged seatbelt issue. Gary Jabe is part of the tourism community. He had one of the first outfitting camps in this territory. It employed people from Dilo. It employed people from Detta. It boosted auto sales, it helped the aviation sector, it helped the Clicquot region as well. Some of my ex-in-laws were the first guides and scouts at Gary's camp at McKay Lake Lodge. They say it's not good to name names. Well, it's a personal matter for me. I went to the previous council in 2014 to address this issue. And to make it business related, it's all about when you get newspapers like this and stories like this, who wants to move their family to a town that city employees rough up people of the public, not to mention senior citizens? So I'm very much here to be a voice to the business community and for our seniors. I see a couple of former councillors here before this era of ethics. And I wanna go talk to Dave Wend and Wendy Beezer and ask you how you would have handled it back in your day. Thank you very much.
Thank you for the question. I'm going to take the transparency and try and put a bit of a business twist on it. So one of my planks in my platform is that I do want City Council and Yellowknife to have more transparency within City Hall. But where I think we can really do that to help the business sector is by making it more clear how construction and how development is coming along and going forward. So allowing access to information as to when roads are going to be done, when sidewalks are going to be done, so people aren't in the dark about when those projects are actually finishing, how long it's going to be before they're actually going to get their access to their storefront back. As I've been door knocking, that seems to be one of the concerns, partly amongst residential, but it does affect the business realm as well. And I think that we can do a better job of actually telling the citizens of Yellowknife when those projects are going to be completed, if they're going to be delayed, and putting a transparency twist on that end of City Hall. Thank you very much.
I'm not totally understanding your question. Could you repeat your question, please?
what are ways that you would look at increasing transparency at City Hall and looking at reducing regulation at City Hall in order to foster a better business community here in Yellowknife? Thank you.
Okay, so we need regulation. Sometimes I think we need to actually start listening to the business community. If we have 20 of the same issues, obviously there's something wrong with the regulations that we have in place. Your question, it's almost like trying to fit a round peg in a square hole in a little bit. So, excuse me. I struggle with this question, but maybe all of our regulations need to be in more common language. We start working with the business community closer. We actually listen to them and see what their issues are, and we take those issues and we deal with them. Thank you.
I guess the first thing I do is, invite the chamber to the table on this one and hear from them on how municipal government can be a bit more responsive and transparent. I get them before the mics at City Hall and then move forward and do everything I can to get them before the mics with the GNWT to make sure that they're accessible and responsive and transparent. There's a lot of in-camera meetings at City Hall as well, which I'd like to see less of, so that we're more on the public record. Access to information is very important, and I find that, I've heard from people in town that we're not really responding well to emails and phone calls and concerns. So I certainly want to be, to improve that and be way more responsive to the people we serve. How does it improve business? I don't think any of that would hurt businesses. So accessible, transparent, inclusive government is really a priority of mine. So thank you.
Thank you for the question, Gerald. It's an interesting one. I think that, in terms of transparency, I think that municipal government is actually a very transparent process. I mean, we hold almost all of our meetings in public, and it is a very public level of government. It's one of the reasons it's my favorite level of government, is that it's incredibly accountable, in the sense that if you don't make decisions that people like, you're going to hear about it pretty quickly. I certainly learned that lesson over the past 3 years. Speaking about accountability, I mean, as you're probably aware, Council recently adopted a public complaints policy. So that was just put into place. I want to turn over to the regulation side of things. I mean, I think, speaking generally, I think that regulation needs to be practical, and we need to ensure that our regulation is achieving the protections of the public that are needed, and also not stifling business unnecessarily. So a couple of things I would point to, big projects the council is going to be looking at over the next term, is one of them is a review of the building bylaw, an overhaul of the building bylaw. That's a long time coming. That's going to be a big project. And certainly I'm committed to ensuring that any regulation of building that comes within that bylaw, that we listen to the development community and ensure that that bylaw reflects modern building standards, and also ensures that we're creating an environment where developers will want to come and build here. Another issue that's going to be coming before council in the near future is Airbnb. Again, a couple of people have mentioned this. I think that one of the reasons it's come up is that this is an industry that's not currently captured under our regulation, and certainly what I've said during meetings about this is that there's reasons to bring Airbnb under the umbrella, but certainly we want to do so in a way that does not stifle the industry, because they're making a big contribution to our tourism industry, and so we need to ensure that when we're regulating business that we achieve a balance. Thank you.
I I find your question on transparency and accountability to business would be the same as council transparency and accountability to residents. I think they fit together. I think the council should improve the public understanding of what they do by maybe having more open house sessions like this, where we can meet with the public, or if I'm elected, where we can meet with the public and explain, or have an open house on getting a forum where residents can voice their opinions of the performance of the council, at least on a semi-annual or annual basis. Some of the misunderstandings between the way the council intends on putting out their bylaws and policies and the way staff delivers that may be an open item for discussion. And I agree with my colleagues when they say that we should be meeting with the business community on a regular basis to get input on the workings of staff and how that matches with the expectation of the voter on things like building, how easy it is to build in Yellowknife, how their performance is on enforcing bylaws such as zoning and land use. I've seen a lot in land use that doesn't match what the intent was. So the rules change halfway through. Well, you might have a development zone for a community and not being followed. Thank you.
Thank you, candidates. I'll take this moment to just plug the Chamber's website for a second. We actually have an advocacy mission on the territorial level regarding open government and transparency, so everyone can take a look at that.